Hello and welcome to the special edition of the AppDevANGLE live from the Open Source Summit North America 2025. My name is Paul Nashawaty, covering the AppDev space and all things open source. I'm joined today by Justin from Peridio. Justin, how you doing?
Oh, excellent. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, thanks for being on. Why don't you tell the audience a little bit about yourself, a little bit about the company?
Sure. So my name's Justin Schneck. Yeah, I'm a Chief Product Officer here at Peridio. We've been working for over 2 decades in the experience chain for embedded product design and development. I've seen it all for people building tiny consumer electronics, industrial automation, all the way through to consumer, to commercial events, and all of that nature. So tiny devices, that's my jam.
Oh, that's really cool, really. I mean, I was trying to get on the keynote this morning, trying to win that Raspberry Pi. I was really excited about that. I didn't get it, unfortunately. but let's jump in. I mean, embedded Linux. What do you have to say about that?
Well, embedded Linux can be really hard. It presents challenges that we don't typically see a lot of in the case of just developing software for purely digital environments. One of the areas I like to talk about really is that the difference is that the web has for software development. It's an environment that we've created ourselves as humans, and we really have deep control over that. Whereas in the embedded market, we're building products that go into the physical space, and that demands some guarantees that we don't get from the pure software digital domains. Things like cosmic rays could cause issues of flipping bits. You know, there's so much that can happen that is the unexpected that you have to be able to be defensive in programming about. So.
Yeah, it sounds a little bit science fiction there, with solar rays and such, but yeah, that's really cool. So let's talk about, let's jump into like your shirt. You have Avocado OS. Avocado OS, I think it's interesting. I like the brand. Tell us about Avocado OS.
Yeah, Avocado is a binary distribution that's made to be able to create AI native runtimes for companies who need to be building embedded products that in this modern age of edge AI can perform some really complex tasks to create the next generation of products quickly. And what we found is why there's a need for this is that there's this traditional dichotomy of choice that we see in the marketplace between something called Yocto, which is extremely high learning curve up front, but does set you up for success with what we need for those things in embedded products. Deterministic runtimes, immutability, reproducibility. And on the other side of things, we see things like desktop distributions. You have Ubuntu and Red Hat and those spaces. And those systems, they're very easy to get up and familiar experience for developers up front, but arguably aren't really scalable towards tens of thousands to millions of devices in the field. Avocado kind of threads the needle in the middle, and we create an experience that is really developer friendly. It gives you that feeling of package management, being a binary distribution, but not at runtime, at build time.
Okay.
And what this enables is that in traditional product development firms, you usually have this bottleneck that occurs between application developers who need to get their stuff onto devices to test, and systems integrators who operate at these slower development life cycles. And now with the advent of edge AI being a thing, in order for that to take off, we're introducing another party to the group, data scientists.
Okay.
And they need to be able to operate at an even faster pace, right?
Yeah, so, this is really exciting, right? Because there's a new kind of a reason you're doing this, right? You've explained the differentiation in the market, why you're doing it, it makes a lot of sense. And so, I know that you have a public beta coming out. Is that available now? Is that something that's coming out soon? When can we get this?
Yeah, well, we came to the Open Source Summit to be able to actually give an official launch on that one.
Very
here
cool.
Today.
Yeah.
And we're coming out swinging with 3 platforms that we chose to start. We're working with the NVIDIA Jetson Orin series boards. We also are supporting the NXP i.MX 93 series.
Okay.
And also for all those developers who happen to have maybe won one of those Raspberry Pis, the Raspberry Pi platform, just because it's ubiquitous.
See, I could have run Avocado on my Raspberry Pi that I didn't get.
That's right. Well, I'm sure that you might be able to have a friend who has 2 or 3 of them in a drawer somewhere.
That's
too.
Perfect. I go find that. All right. Well, let's. I think I have to touch on here NVIDIA, the NVIDIA relationship. I mean, that with there's a lot of buzz in the market. NVIDIA is kind of obviously a hot industry darling out there today. Let's talk a little bit about the relationship there.
Yeah. So leading up to the summit, we've been wanting to put together a demo that was really compelling and captivating for the people in the audience, right? So we worked closely with NVIDIA leading up to be able to illustrate and demonstrate how easy it is for those data scientists to quickly iterate on their devices. Jetson series stuff is complicated. I mean, running edge AI in itself is a complicated stack. And the demo that we put together with them is running this product that they have called Triton Inference Server that has some great benefits. It can do live model reloading in the fly. It can do model ensembling. And it provides a really nice development experience because together with our hardware in the loop debugging technologies, then it allows these data science groups to be able to quickly see changes in their models and enumerate on them really quickly on the physical hardware instead of it being virtualized in a domain. So
are we going to see Jensen up there on stage with a Raspberry Pi running Avocado pretty soon?
Yeah, I would hope so.
That'd be really cool. Yeah, really awesome. Yeah, I look forward to seeing that. So, okay, let's take a look at other manufacturers, top silicon manufacturers that are interested, right, in this whole approach?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, that dichotomy that we see of choice, so these top silicon manufacturers, these are the best that they have at offering to their customers. As I mentioned, Yocto being a steep learning curve, but desktop distributions being easy, they wanted something that's going to enable their customers to be able to move more quickly without sacrificing that ability to go to production. Usually we'll see if you get started on a prototype with something like Ubuntu, you're going to hit this moment where you need to productionize it.
Right.
And when you harden systems like that, you kind of put the seatbelts on and you make it difficult for developers to move quickly. You know, the more you harden a system, the more difficult it is for them to iterate.
Sure. Yeah.
So we've been having a lot of conversations with some of these top manufacturers about this problem that they experience and how Avocado can really help offer a solution that doesn't have those compromises.
Yeah. So who are some of those manufacturers? Can you share those names now, or is that still in kind of development?
It's still in progress. That's on fine. Having yep. some more of those conversations together, but every one of them is experiencing this kind of pain. And we see a lot of these example cases that are in the field of acquisitions that are happening for hardware companies, because they know that they need to become more vertically integrated with software solutions so that they can sell more silicon and actually make the promise of edge AI start to take off in a sustainable way.
Yeah, I mean, I think that makes a lot of sense. I mean, there's definitely growth. When I think of my practice, I talk about past, present, and future, and I talk about moving from heritage environments to the next generation, which is modernized approaches using depending on whatever the location you're at. So you can be in your core data center, you can be in an edge location, in the cloud, wherever it may be. But when we think about the expansion of these applications, there's all sorts of workloads that are happening across the board, right? And there's also difficulty in kind of managing some of these workloads, right? So when we think about that from embedded devices, right, let's talk a little bit about the tooling around embedded devices. What are your thoughts around how Avocado OS can help with the tooling of the OSs?
Well, we think about things a little bit different. Well, actually, the inspiration comes from battle-tested and deployed opinions that come from things like systemd, like, technology in the embedded Linux space, it's just Linux running smaller. And so the user group, the user space group from in Linux, they've been doing a lot of work in service of making distribution installations for server and cloud architectures more hygienic. And by that I mean like they were making it so that they can install multiple distributions alongside of each other, and also make it so that they can clean up some of the legacy in the space.
Okay.
And so we are depending on a lot of these opinions that have been formed and tested from upstream cases and applying them to rethink the way that we structure embedded devices. Typically in embedded systems, we would build monolithic root file systems that would, you'd ping pong between an A-B system. So today your root file system with your machine learning models, you might be like, oh, it takes up 250 megabytes. And then like tomorrow, so you lay out your partitions such that you give yourself maybe like half a gig of space, right? Tomorrow your data scientist comes to you and goes, guess what? 1.5 gigabytes I need. Yeah. Well, that can lead to a really problematic, risky repartitioning in the field. That's a one-way ticket. And that complication means that we have to be really knowledgeable and prepared up front. Avocado takes an approach where, using this technology from systemd called system extensions, we let you have an environment where you can introduce packages at build time, you can create an OS tree that acts as an overlay at runtime, and that overlays on top of our very thin, minimal root file systems, so that way your partitions can remain consistent, and all of the rest of the disk is your playground of a dynamic space that we format to let you build your extensions. Therefore, if that size increases, increases or decreases, you still get all the guarantees that we need for determinism, runtime support for embedded devices, but you don't have to deal with that hard problem of repartitioning in the field.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's you're overcoming some of the challenges that we currently see today, especially with heritage environments. I mean, I think it's you're overcoming those. So you mentioned a couple of things I want to be kind of clarify. That it's so I understand is the persona you're talking to, you mentioned data scientists, but you're also, well, you're talking very much like a developer-centric kind of view. Is it more of like the line of business developer, citizen developer as a data scientist, or is it a professional developer that would be your target?
Well, I mean, anybody who's wanting to be able to build a product, and you know, really in order for us to have this sustainable growth period for edge AI to take off, we're going to need to get tools into people's hands so that they can have these innovative ideas come to life quickly.
Right.
I think back to the 2010 era where you know, we started to hear about IoT and all of the same complications of building embedded systems existed then, including ones around how do I even make user interfaces? Well, in this time, kiosks became a big thing. You know, we started to see Chrome-less web browsers enabling existing web development teams the power to feel like they can actually build embedded products quickly without having to have really low-level experienced, you know, Linux, low-level developer talent on board. We're going to see the same thing with edge AI. I mentioned data scientists and average, like, generalized developers because it's going to take tools that let them feel capable to create products to spur that innovation spike and have it so that they can start to be able to bring their ideas to life as well.
So it's very cool. So I think it, and what I heard you say, just kind of translated into kind of simplicity views, is like it's bridging the old with the new, right? It's like it's basically taking your existing approach, and it sounds like there's a migration path here that can occur pretty seamlessly.
Mm-hmm.
Is that true?
Yeah, and the nice thing is that since we're leveraging a lot of tools and opinions, but redesigning the, using those, the way that we approach the composition of an embedded system, we're not really introducing a lot of new code. And so, you know, we're taking battle-tested ideas that happened in the cloud, but we're adapting them with the right approach for embedded development. And that means that we're getting production level grade results from day zero without having to wait a long period of time because we might be doing things off the beaten path.
Sure, sure. Sorry, let me ask you a question, Justin. So a year from now, when we're sitting here at Open Source Summit, where do you want the company to be?
Well, I would love to be able to see more people kicking the tires on this and having a nice growth period. We're getting a lot of great feedback from developers here at the conference. It's been a fantastic event to be able to see how they're receiving it.
Yeah.
You know, and I would think in a year from now, it would be great to have the community start to flourish and grow and have more people being able to like build products using this this platform and this design pattern. And so I just truly want to be able to see what people can do.
Yeah.
I want to see the products. I want them to exist. And I think that enabling this is going to let them create the stuff that I just want to have like the joy of playing with
myself.
Of course, right?
That's awesome, that's awesome. Well, I'm super excited about your success so far. I'm really excited to see where it's going in the future, so that's awesome. Justin, thank you for being here. Your insights have been awesome. I'm really excited about seeing where it's going. And thank you to the audience for tuning in. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. That wraps up this episode, but we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talent shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building an AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social. If you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach me at paulnn@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.